Hello everyone and welcome to the Dirty Side of the Grid podcast, where we've turned up late to qualifying, but because Yusuf's white, Bernie Eccleston pulled some strings and said we can go to the front of the grid. I'm Mohammed, I'm joined by my co-host Yusuf, and this is going to be part two of our season review. We actually thought it would get done in one podcast, but we're going to be here for an extra hour filming the second half of the season, so... I mean, this should be a little bit quicker, seeing as we're a bit fresh in our minds.
Yeah, true.
We'll end up waffling anyway. So, the summer break ends, and we go to Belgium for the Belgian Grand Prix in Spa. Personally, one of my favourite tracks, and normally a pretty decent race, you could say. I don't know, you're a fan of Spa normally?
I really enjoy Spa, but I think this year was the... The way the race was managed, I think, you know how they're saying that incident at the end of the year was throwing the sport into disrepute?
Yeah.
This race threw the sport into disrepute, literally, like, as in, like, there's nothing you can say other than that. Like, obviously, we know now that they're not going to refund any of the people who paid for the tickets.
Yeah, so they...
I think that's unacceptable. People went there in the rain to watch a race for you to do four laps and be like... No, we're not giving you money back. But I paid for a race. I didn't pay for this nonsense.
It's right. So we go out. We're doing qualifying. Vettel and Norris are on the track. It's raining extremely heavily. I think it was... Yeah, this was qualifying, wasn't it?
Yeah, and Norris crushes.
Vettel says red flag, green flags are still out. Norris goes for his lap, crashes at Eau Rouge into the barrier at Radion at the top of the hill. Vettel goes past, checks if he's all right, and then says on the radio, like, look, this is exactly what I said, red flag, like, what are you doing? And to be perfectly honest, when there's no agenda, they're like, clearly Vettel, there's no agenda from Vettel there. There's nothing to gain for him. There's no reason for him to say red flag other than safety. So why would you not listen to him? He's a driver out there on the track. Like,
I think especially like someone like Sebastian, who's had a lot of experience driving in awful conditions, so he'd know that, yeah, this is about, we need to stop.
Yeah,
really, so compared to say like Nikita wouldn't have that experience.
Yeah, you wouldn't trust him. He would have spun wet or dry anyway, so can't really chat about that. But yeah, so we get onto the race, it's raining. They say it's gonna be delayed by a little bit. That's normal. Sometimes races are delayed, that's just how it is. Gets delayed a little bit longer, it keeps getting delayed. And this was the main problem. As much as they're trying to get the race going and they're trying to, for the sake of entertainment, the tickets, the sport in general, but all of the rest of it, sponsorship money probably. They're trying to get the race underway, makes sense. But here's, like you said, the first sign of...
The FIA going nuts.
Yeah, they decide to do a couple laps under the safety car, normally just to test out the conditions, fine. But I'm pretty sure normally laps under the safety car don't count for this, seeing as they've just started, like it wasn't...
They didn't race. That's yeah, if they like raced for like a few laps, then it's too dangerous. People would not have been as upset. But you literally, we paid our money to go watch a race where they went for four laps behind safety car. Then he gave half points.
Yeah, and the half points thing is just as ridiculous, to be honest.
Why? Like, I don't think you should cancel the race because, like, obviously, like, someone like George, he went out there and he, like, I think we didn't comment on
this. Oh, yeah, of course, yeah. George puts his second in a Williams.
George and Williams out-qualifies Lewis Hamilton and the Mercedes. I think, like, he would have been on pole if by, like, a fraction of, like, a second.
Yeah, he was actually on for pole, yeah.
So I think someone like that should not be robbed of, like, his chance at getting a pole. Especially if it's dry wet, he would have had a chance at staying at the front. Obviously, a podium is, like, he wouldn't have gotten a podium, but he could have gotten points.
Yeah.
But... The way they did it, obviously George and Williams, I don't think they cared. I think they would have happy the race finished in four laps because they got podium.
Yeah.
But I think for everyone else, it's just like, I think everyone was happy for George because you've seen the amount of work he's put in at Williams. But at the same time, everyone's like, this is his first podium and it's not exactly...
It was his first points for Williams, I'm pretty sure as well. I don't think he had points at this point.
No, I think he scored in Hungary. Or is it? No, Latifi.
Latifi got points in Hungary. And then,
yeah.
Yeah, it was just awful. It was embarrassing. So the way F1 works is these calendars, if you've seen them with their logos and their Instagrams and stuff, their companies. And to get on the calendar, F1 doesn't pay them to use the venue. The venue pays F1 to have the honour of F1 cars gracing the circuit. And what they have to do is, they pay millions for these deals and stuff, which is why I said before, like, the calendars are bidding war at this point. They pay all this money and then have to make that back, which is why the ticket prices are ridiculous. So people are paying hundreds of pounds, maybe more
watch,
on top of that.
Yeah, to watch four laps of under the safety car.
They're travelling, they're doing all of this, they're going out to the Belgian woods. You know, Spa isn't exactly in the middle of Brussels, it's in the countryside somewhere
and
in the middle
of nowhere. It's extremely
hard
to get from there back home because of the rain and stuff. It's actually extremely hard to get
there's out. No grandstands as well because it's an old circuit and stuff. They're just sat on the hills, like in the mud, on their little like unfoldable camping chairs or foldable camping chairs and all of this stuff.
And then they don't even get like their money back. I find that so bizarre. Like the F1 didn't even issue an apology, you know, like We're sorry that the race went bad. No, like
they just posted their Verstappen wins graphic and then moved on with their day. Like
I find that to be incredibly insulting to the fans.
It's disgusting, yeah. And obviously the circuit, I can't speak too much about the, you know, the financial situation of the circuit itself. But for them to do something, I'd say it's cool. But F1 itself as a company, like, should not be leaving the circuit to do all of this stuff. And they should definitely be offering something. Because as of now, the circuit has offered an F1 TV subscription for a year for everyone. I think that's worth about, like, £70. And then they've also offered... I think they've offered a raffle. So you can win your tickets for next year, but not everyone gets them. It's a raffle. I don't know how many
but
people are going to get
at
them.
At least people got the subscription. So there is kind of... This is what I'm saying. There is some sort of, like... apology of like, okay, we know that, but we'll give you like the, obviously it's not the same price, but I understand the idea behind it. But the logic, like the logic between behind F1, I think pays like half of its revenue back to all the teams for the competition, the other half just goes nowhere. So obviously you can spare like a few hundred quid for these
yeah, days. Honestly, like these poor fans, like they're sat out, and you've got to remember, even me, I'm just in the comfort of my home with my laptop sat about. I remember I have my laptop on charge like all the time. I unplug it, I go to the living room, I'm gonna watch the race. I was making lunch and stuff, getting ready, all of this. My laptop was about to die by the time they announced that the race was cancelled. I spent all day just waiting around. It was like 4 hours or something total. With cancellations
and then it would have taken like 2-3 hours to get back to Brussels because of how bad it is and how bad the rain is.
And then some of these fans must have flown out as well. Belgium isn't all of
the
trains, but like
all of that as well.
It's embarrassing. All of it was embarrassing. It was.
George got his first points though. So George got his first podium. I think you have to give it to George this year. He has been. I think his first half of the season was okay. He was finishing P14, P13. But, like, I think one of the points I forgot to mention this last episode, was his lap at Silverstone. I think that was the first time he went into Q3, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, really?
And his lap was amazing. You can see, like, every time he'd go near the grandstand, the fans would be like, "Who?" The fans were reacting more to George than they were to Lewis. Like, Lewis's lap was like, "Yeah, come." But George was going by, and, like, if you watched that lap, it was amazing. It was like, "Yeah." And then with every time, you know, like we got past, it was amazing. He got it into Q3. I think that was the very first time he did it. And so I think from Silverstone onwards, you kind of see like Williams have improved their car a lot. They scored points in Hungary, got a podium in Belgium. But the car has improved a lot.
Yeah,
like, you have to give them that. And you have to give George like obviously he sacrificed his race in Hungary because he's like, I'll stay out to hold them up for Nikki.
Oh yeah.
And he was, people like made a meme out of it that he's only doing this for Toto to hear it, you know. but that shows that's how desperate he was for the team to actually score points, because he's been there for like 3 years. They've not scored points, and he's like, he's willing to sacrifice. I'll sacrifice my race just, and Nikki ended up scoring points. But so I was very happy for like him over. I think from here it starts to kind of look a bit better across the season.
Yeah, things look up for him, definitely. And actually, interestingly, at this point, it wasn't announced fully, but Bottas and Russell both knew where they were going. So they had been told the news of where they were going next year, which...
Oh, did he say that?
No, it was said afterwards. It was in the Autosport podcast. He must have said it, I think. Mm. But there are some funny clips, if you remember.
When was it? Was it announced? I forgot when it was announced.
It was announced
going into Monza. Whatever.
No, it was after Monza. It might have been like a Russia-Turkey time, maybe. Maybe later.
I forgot when it was.
Can't remember. I'll have to look it up. But there's some interesting interviews with George when they say, you see P2, you did very well. How are you going to do all of this? And they'll ask him, do you know where you're going to be next year and all of that? And he has a really smug look on his face and all of this.
Yeah, he laughed a bit. But I think from Silverstone, you can kind of tell, he did very well at hiding it, though. I don't think he went and, gave it away. But
no, not completely. But as in, definitely
No, but if you go look at, last year after Abu Dhabi and stuff, and people are like, oh, sorry, it wasn't Abu Dhabi, it was, is it Qatar? Bahrain.
When
he did really well last year. For Lewis.
Sakir.
Yeah. See, the difference in Qatar and Sakir is actually, there is a difference in
racing. I get them, yeah. The Austrian stereo one confuses
me. But anyways, people are like, oh, you're going and stuff. And he'd have that same smile, even though he knew he wasn't going. So, yeah. I think it was just at that point he really didn't know when people were asking him so much. So he's like, I have to stick to the script they gave me. You know, that type of thing.
Yeah. But decent stuff. Spa, I guess. That was the main talking point. Spa was awful. And the fact points were handed out, even if they were half points, still awful. That was not a race. Sure, George deserved something for P2, but he did not deserve points. People don't deserve
Spa
points.
Spa and the next race were just boring, basically.
Yeah, moving on to Zandvoort, it's
boring. You literally have boring written.
I wrote down boring.
I have boring written for France, Styria, and Austria. Boring.
Zandvoort was boring. Max, fair play to him. So people talking about pressure of the championship, pressure of everything, pressure of his home race. I mean, he's the reason that this track is back on the calendar. And
the fans,
you did well.
You have to give them, the race was very boring, but I think the one thing you can say, the whole weekend, the fans were amazing. The fans were bouncing the whole, you felt you're going to a festival, even though it's just a Formula
1. Yeah, it looked like the cross between a festival and a football match.
The atmosphere at Zandvoort, I think, was one of, I think this year is the best out of all the whole calendar.
Yeah, you probably say that. Yeah.
Kimi didn't race this race.
Kubica
came in for him because he got COVID.
The
man with one hand finished ahead of Nikita Mazepin, even though he only raced two races this season.
Yes.
In the standings, Nikita Mazepin is the 21st. He's not even 20. He's not even last. He's minus one.
That's so embarrassing. Honestly, these pay drivers are next level. But
no, Nicky's actually good now. Nicky's picked up his pace.
He's improved. He's improved.
Well, Stroll is okay. Stroll's not too bad.
I feel like he's been the most untalked about driver all year.
Yeah, he hasn't really done anything.
Disappeared into nothing. Mm. People used to hate him for being a pay driver and stuff.
But now you have someone like Nikita Mazepin, so Stroll looks like, you know, angel. When is moving on to Monza? I think Zandvoort, not really much to say.
Yeah, Zandvoort, I mean, the last thing I wrote down for Zandvoort was, but this was the, if anyone remembers this, Bottas was told not to set the fastest lap to allow Lewis to do it because they needed the points. And Bottas, although he slowed down in the final sector, he still set it anyway, which was, it was funny. Yeah. That's about all we've got there. Lewis still took it off him, obviously.
There's a lot of issues with qualifying, though, because of how tight the track was. You had that incident between Sebastian and Mick.
Oh, yeah.
That's it. That's literally it. I think Zandvoort, the qualifying has to be managed a bit more. But otherwise,
yeah, they need to. Obviously, they tried this near the end of the season to introduce rules about backing up and stuff. It didn't work. So they need to look into
it. It was
that
in
problem.
Saudi, because they slowed down incredibly.
They said between.
We'll but then people would slow down right after that corner.
Exactly. Sorry.
So the logic is bad.
Right. So Monza, we have a sprint race where, if I get the results up quickly of the sprint race, I believe Lewis put it first, but his start was actually horrific. So he ended up going down to
fourth or fifth,
something like that.
So what's his name? Daniel wins. I think Daniel wins his own pole. Pole, and then it's Verstappen, and then it's Lando.
So for the sprint grid, Bottas took an engine penalty, so he puts it first, but Lewis came second, and then Bottas takes the penalty. So he goes down. This was actually the first time we saw the difference between the Mercedes new power unit and the old one, because the way Bottas could overtake the McLarens was actually quite interesting. Lewis would didn't pull alongside. He'd pull alongside the McLaren and then just...
He didn't overtake any McLarens during the weekend. He didn't come any anywhere close to the...
Yeah, they were clear.
You said Valtteri overtook the McLarens. He didn't come close to them during the weekend. They just took off.
No, I mean, sorry, I mean during the
race.
Who did he overtake? I saw
literally, they took 1-2.
I've confused myself now. Yeah. I remember him overtaking
the Ferraris and Red Bull.
Yeah, that must have been.
Perez.
Yeah, he overtook everyone. Sorry, I was confusing myself. I hadn't.
That was a good recovery drive. He did get a podium.
He did all right, to be fair.
No, he did very well. You have to say, come back from P20 to P3. Incredibly impressive.
Right, starting grid. So, for the starting grid...
Verstappen won, not Ricciardo.
Verstappen first, Ricciardo second, Norris third, Hamilton fourth. So he did finish fourth. Leclerc and Sainz in fifth and sixth. Then we get on to the race. And yeah, Ricciardo and Norris, first and second.
With
quite close. Norris,
Norris asking, do you want me to stay in this position? Is that what's good for the
team? That was so sad. It would have been nice to see them fight, to be fair. I feel like
No. I think like McLaren would have, like, because Ricciardo was in the lead, if Norris was in the lead, they would have made them hold position. I think it was the case where whoever was in the lead would hold position, like whoever second would hold position.
They weren't going to tell them to fight, but I feel like it would have been nice to hold.
Because they're risking like everything, so that hold position. And they were quick, they were rapid that weekend.
Yeah,
so.
Only 1-2 of the season. Their first 1-2 since like 2010, their first win since like 2012.
Brazil 2012.
Yeah, it was Jensen.
Jensen Button, yes. That's how long ago it was.
Crashed into him. What do we have? Bottas finishing third.
Bottas came from P20 to P3, and you're saying it's an okay drive.
Okay, yeah, he did pretty well. I'm surprised. How did Bottas overtake people?
Because he had a new engine.
Yeah, that makes
sense. He had like incredible performance gap, so he had to do that.
Leclerc fourth, and then we get onto the actual incident.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
I forgot about that.
Max Verstappen with an extremely slow stop. This is after the rule was changed so that they have to do the pit stops a bit slower.
But that's targeted firmly at Red Bull.
Yeah, pretty much. The excuse was it's not safe. These stops are so fast. But to change it mid-season's a bit weird. It's something you might change going into the next season if you think about it. But yeah, I don't know.
FIA
not great stuff.
Weird.
Yeah, another strange one from the FIA. Lewis also had a slow stop, not as slow, and he's a pit stop ahead of Verstappen, so he should have come out ahead of Max with fresh tyres, but, you know,
they
come next to each other. And here's the thing, so taking this incident, if we say, out of context, these two drivers, and this incident is taken completely by itself, I'd say it's Lewis's fault, he should have given room. Consistently with what I think about leaving room and stuff, I'd say you take this incident completely isolated, you say these are just two random drivers and we don't think about what the FIA have been doing all year.
He didn't leave side space, by just side. Like Max didn't leave space.
Yeah, I'd say he should have left space. But taking this into the context of everything else, blah, 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 once again, Max doesn't back down. This is the second time Lewis has stood his ground, the first time with Silverstone. And once again, it's...
Max was on top of him by the end of it.
Did you see, actually, Sky Sports started using that and then the clip of Verstappen going into the barriers at Silverstone and putting Merry Christmas in front of it?
Really?
Did you not see this? Oh, there was so much backlash. So they started using clips of stuff in general to say Merry Christmas as part of their little intro before and after the advert breaks. And they used Max going on top of Lewis's head. Like, they just have them crash, Crofty screaming, oh! And then it comes up and then it slowly goes white and says Merry Christmas. And then they did the same thing with Max. So Max is like flying across the gravel trap. And then Crofty's like, oh, and they've touched. And just as he hits the barrier, it all goes white and they say, Merry Christmas.
Doesn't seem like a good idea since one of them could have died in one of those. You have to give the FIA, though, like credit for the halo. I think people have seen how useful the halo is.
Definitely.
And you don't realize how massive those tires are until you have it on top of like someone's head and you're like, well, that tire is massive.
It's insane. And then Lewis, there's actually clips of, I think it might have been Ted's notebook, or there's something afterwards. There's people with cameras walking around in the paddock, as they always do.
And one of them caught Lewis, and he was following him around. And Lewis, instead of like turning his head to see who it is, he turns his whole body like that to look at the camera and then carries on walking. So he has like barely any movement in his neck, which is mad. But yeah, they crash.
But see, after this, like, Helmut Marko came out and was like, oh, if Lewis is really sick, he wouldn't be in New York doing the Met Gala. Like, I find that like comment to be incredibly, like, I don't want to say, like, is it insulting in a way? Like, going to an event and having dinner with people, if my neck hurts, doesn't literally, like, makes no difference. It's, and plus, you're essentially, you're going so far to cover yourself that you're saying that, nah, nothing happened to him. Even when your driver was at fault, and your driver was said to be at fault, and he parked his car on top of him, and a tire pressed down, like, Formula cars aren't light. Like, as in, they're light compared to road cars, but they're heavy.
Yeah.
And you're saying, nah, it's fine. What are you
he's
talking
stupid,
about?
Because that's the funny part. It's a good point to make, actually, because after Silverstone, obviously, they completely slate Lewis. They call him all of this, and they talk about the abuse,
but
don't do it. And they
Mercedes didn't do the opposite.
After Monza, Mercedes don't abuse anyone. And on top of that, Red Bull are all saying it's a racing incident. Which is funny, because if it was, if you could have said it was Lewis's fault in any sense, they would have done it. But they couldn't defend Max. So they tried to do what they could. Oh no, it's a racing incident. He's not actually hurt. This is, you know, like,
yeah. But this is the interesting part. This is why I actually don't like Red Bull, because, you know, like Mercedes, when it came to the other one, they're like, at least like, we didn't know like Max was ill, or like, you know, like hope he's better or whatever. But
yeah,
they're trying to make an excuse of, oh no, Lewis is fine. He's not fine. Like, instead of dealing with the fact that he's ill and being like, oh sorry, I didn't know he's ill or whatever, you're blaming him like, nah, he's fine, he's fine. Boy had a Formula One car parked on his head, what are you talking about?
It's, I don't know, Red Bull's antics at it again. But we move on from that. Now we move on to Russia.
Russia's like the heartbreak of the season, you know?
Yeah. It was sad to see. You didn't want
to
see
Lando
it.
Lando took pole. Lando led most of the race after he overtook Carlos. Lando did incredibly well. And then I think the team bowed down to the... Like, McLaren haven't led a race and been at the front since... Obviously, they had the Monza thing, but Monza thing was clear. But in, like, changing conditions, realistically, since, like, Brazil 2012, maybe. So they haven't been the lead car. And I think it just got to them, and they couldn't do it.
They haven't properly fought for a win since, like, 2014.
No, 2012.
Was their car good in 13? Mm-hmm. Oh, actually, no, it wasn't. Yeah, it wasn't old.
So it was a bit of a, I think, a shock for them, and they didn't know what to do, and then Lando ended up finishing P7, I think, and it was incredibly heartbreaking, because
like
it wasn't his fault. I think people come out and say it's Lando's fault, but it's not really. They asked him, how do you feel? He said, I feel like I'm okay. He's obviously never led a race. He's talking about how he feels now, but the difference is with Lewis, they told him, we have the data, this is what it says, come in now. Lewis, that's the thing, people say, Lewis, listen. Lewis didn't listen to them. Lewis was on the radio complaining that, no, I want to stay out. But they forced him in. But Lando, I've listened to the whole radio. They asked him, how does it feel? He's like, it's fine. Shut up, I don't want to talk. Obviously, he doesn't want to talk. He's in an incredibly stressful position.
Yeah.
He could get his first win, all of this. And they don't give him any information. If they tell him the rain is going to intensify, what is he going to say? I want to pit now.
That's the main one. So Mercedes say the race is going to get worse. McLaren say, they don't say it's going to get worse, they just say it's going to stay like this. So he's assuming, like, oh, it's doable, just a couple more laps. What's that, like, 5 minutes? Fine. But it turns out it was actually getting worse. That's what Mercedes
said. I blame the team more than I blame
McLaren should have been listening to other teams' radios. If Mercedes is saying it's going to get worse and they're going to pit,
just pit.
You might as well pit. Like,
yeah,
it's, I don't know. It's tough. There's still a really funny clip, actually, of Stroll. And they say, oh, Stroll, do you want to come in? He's like, no, it's fine. And then as he says that, he goes sliding off into the barrier. I'll link that one. See, that will be the first video that we put in the
Verstappen put in a decent drive, though. He went from P20 to P2. This was the
best.
Yeah,
I mean, oh yeah, so he took his penalty. So if we go from the beginning, Lewis crashed, I believe, in practice, which was unlike him. Obviously, it's practice, but it's still fairly big crash, probably the first one we've seen from Lewis in a while. He then also crashes on the way on the pit entry in qualifying, which, I mean, I'm not saying these are major events, but it's just something to note. Max takes his engine penalty, which is why he's last. On his comeback, on his way up the grid, he's doing extremely well, all of this stuff, solid stuff, overtakes Bottas so easily.
Bottas just lets him through.
Yeah,
Bottas also took like a new ICU.
Oh yeah, this was Bottas' engine penalty season. He was taking like a penalty every race.
Yeah, Bottas took like 6 engines by the end of the season.
Yeah, it was something weird like that.
I think Mercedes strange need to plan. Work on their engine for next year. Like, they need reliability to go up.
Yeah, their performance is struggling at the moment. It's just weird. But, yeah, Lando, we've spoken about this, winning and then ends up finishing 7th, which is, it's so sad for him. He could have won. Interestingly, actually, on top of the stuff, on the Autosport podcast I mentioned that I listened to, they said that Lewis was also told in this radio or Mercedes were aware Max had pitted. So they tell everyone come in. Max does because he's got nothing to lose. He's stuck in 7th. He's made his comeback driver. Now he's stuck in 7th. He can't go anywhere. So he pits just as a might as well go for it. Lewis doesn't want to pit. He stays out an extra lap. And then they say, oh, like, we know Max is on Inters. He's pitted. We might as well cover him. So then he comes in and that's when he wins. So another one interesting to note. Max, I mean, he got so lucky with the rain, but fair play to him. Obviously, we spoke about luck in the last one. He didn't have great luck running into the summer break.
I think up to the summer break, it was all against him, really. Like, the only reason Lewis caught up to him was because Max DNF'd twice because of a Mercedes crashing into him, so.
Well, he finished, was it 9th in Hungary, but that's, like, 2 points from what should have been, like, a lot.
Yeah. And he would have either won or came P2 at least. So yeah, we'd have lost, like, realistically lost, like, what, 6 points or 7 points? Worst case scenario, we've lost 8 if Lewis got fastest lap as well.
But he ended up losing 18.
Exactly.
This was Lewis's 100th win as well.
Yeah. I think that was... See, that, like, out of... like, it's just, like, because Lando lost it at the end, you're kind of like, yeah, he got his 100th win, but...
Yeah, I completely forgot about this. Yeah. Because, I mean, people weren't really... He was chasing down Lando and he was close, but it didn't really look like he was actually...
No, Lando did a good job keeping Lewis behind. Like, he genuinely did a good job.
So,
yeah, it's just sad.
That was the 100th win. Something I actually forgot about as well. Like, I remember where his 91st was because he equaled it in the Nürburgring. But, like...
The only one I remember is, like, Turkey, where he won, basically, 7th.
Oh, yeah, I remember.
That's the only
that
one
was a very good win. Well, we're moving on to Turkey now. Bottas wins ahead of Max Verstappen.
You know,
I can't believe Bottas actually won a race.
Like, someone was commenting, Carlos, who said that, oh, you know, like, you won, and I just... It's like, Bottas won a race. And I went back, and I was thinking, I was like, no, Bottas didn't win a race. And I actually had to open the website, go through all the races, like, Bottas won a race. Oh, my God, he actually won. I totally forgot.
It's so weird.
Bottas took pole and just led from the start, and no one saw him.
Yeah,
it was
weird to
surprising.
See.
Like, took fastest
especially number. After last year, because last year in Turkey, he spun like 14 times and stayed in the midfield. So.
And he took fastest lap as well.
Weird stuff. Oh, yeah. What a guy. Incredible domination from Bottas, really.
The only thing I think, Hamilton didn't have a good weekend, so the only good thing was he took away points from Verstappen. I think at this point, going after Turkey, you can honestly say it was Max's championship to lose.
Yeah,
like at this point it's because Lewis was so far behind, you expect him to win at this point. I don't know how much you can get the points up, I think, on the Sky Sports one.
So
at this point, like, he's firmly ahead.
There is. So the gap's what, 12 points.
Yeah. So he is a good
It was 6. Whoops. Am I actually looking in the right place?
Yeah. But that's the thing, going into the US and Mexico and Brazil and all of those, the reason I say it's his championship to lose is because those tracks were very firmly in Red Bull's camp. Like, all the other races that were coming up, I think the only one that you could look at and say could be Mercedes dominated is Saudi.
The US was meant to be Mercedes.
It's the US and Saudi, the rest are seen as Red Bull tracks.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, we didn't really know much about the new ones, but, like, even then, you'd assume Red Bull were going to do pretty well on them. I mean, they're street races, and they're, like, high downforce, so you just back Red Bull for those. But, yeah, so Bottas wins. Lewis was... He's, like... Lewis he took an engine penalty, so that's the first one. The second thing is he's out on his tyres, and I think Verstappen's second at this point. Lewis is either third or fourth, and Perez and Leclerc and those kind of drivers are catching up to him. There's about 8 laps to go, and Mercedes are waiting for it to transfer from inters to slicks because there'd been, like, no rain. But the problem with the Turkey surface, even though it wasn't as bad as last year, it was still not... Like, it just wasn't drying up. So they pit Lewis. He really didn't want to, but they pit him just to, you know, try and avoid a puncture and stuff like this. He gets new intermediates. He's trying to hunt everyone down. He can't. The new intermediates have, like, no pace. Someone who did get that strategy to work was Ocon. He did the entire race with
no stops.
It's impressive for him, to be fair. Let's get it. I don't think it was that impressive. 10.
Yeah, but he's still finishing the points. So.
It was alright, to be fair. Where did... Let's see where Alonso finished. 16th. Yeah. So, there's that. More points lost, but...
Lewis also, like, there was that big fight between him and Perez, where Perez did incredibly well.
It's a nice battle, yeah. This was the first time Perez and Lewis had properly had a little, like...
tussle.
Yeah. And it was good to see, actually, to be fair. It was quite entertaining. Well, that brings us on to the US.
Nothing much happened in the US.
No, not really. I mean, so, the start... Bottas... No, not Bottas, sorry. What's his name? Max gets pole. Max gets pole, which was very surprising because this is meant to be like a Mercedes track and all of this, and everyone's saying Mercedes is going to do well. Max gets pole, and now everyone's thinking, oh, what's going to happen now? Into turn one, Lewis, like, finesses him completely. He takes the lead. But Red Bull's pace was... It was very strong, to be fair to them. And they ended up winning just about. Obviously, this was when... Lewis is on fresh tyres and he's hunted down Max to the end, as he normally does. And Crofty's hyping this up and they're saying, oh, this is it. He's but just he within really, DRS. He was outside DRS the whole time. Like, yeah. It was.
He doesn't make it to, like...
Yeah, it was never that close. It was close, sure. He was within 2 seconds, but by the time he reached that 2 second cushion, he just...
There was not enough time. I think there was like one lap left or something like that.
Yeah, Mick Schumacher held up Verstappen a little bit, but then gave him DRS. So, ended it there.
Perez is sick with no water.
Yeah, so Perez actually, they said afterwards he had an illness. It wasn't COVID, but he was just sick. He was really sick. And his drink didn't work either. So, he's doing the entirety of the US Grand Prix. This is like autumn time, so still pretty warm, but obviously inside a Formula One car. 90 minutes of pure sweat. And he didn't even have his drink.
And he got finished, on podium.
Yeah, he finished third.
Yeah, I have to give him to that. Give him that.
Solid performance from him.
I think that's everything.
Yeah, that sums up the US.
Mexico is just... I don't like Mexico. I'm very firmly against Mexico. I think it's a very boring track.
Yeah, so this is when we started the... I think Mexico was our first podcast.
Yeah, Mexico was our first podcast.
And well, the first one we actually put out.
And I complained about Mexico being very boring because nothing happened in Mexico.
I didn't really want to believe you before the race, but now afterwards, I completely got it afterwards.
Max struck pole and Max just ran away with it. Like, he finished 16 seconds ahead of
him. In qualifying, he came third.
Oh, he came third. Oh.
But obviously, this was when I had my rant about Bottas just letting him past. So he overtakes both Mercedes into turn one, and then that's it. Like, the race was won at that point.
I have to say, like, this is what I'm saying about Hamilton's defense is bad.
Like, that wasn't Lewis's fault.
No, but, is this where he they left the inside way open for him? And
they left the outside way open for him. Not, it's just in general awful coordination. I think Lewis slyly mentioned this in an interview afterwards. He was kind of saying, oh, Bottas, I watched the replay, like, Bottas could have blocked him, but he didn't. And all it was not great, to be honest.
He doesn't want to say anything about his teammate, but he's like, he didn't do well.
He doesn't, yeah, especially after he keeps saying that he's the greatest teammate ever and all of this stuff, which we don't believe that. Nico's the reason best teammate actually, ever.
I think actually his best teammate was Jensen Button. Because they didn't fight.
Oh, in terms of chemistry and stuff.
Yeah, but they also they pushed each other to win races.
Yeah.
Obviously, if they had a better car, I think they would have won the championship. One of them would have won it. But there wasn't that animosity he had with Nico. There wasn't that animosity he had with Fernando. Obviously, Hecky, you should have mentioned. Valtteri mentioned.
So he had...
The only one...
So it was Alonso, they'd fight. Yeah. Hecky, Kovalainen.
Useless.
Yeah. Then it was Button, wasn't it?
Yeah, Button was the only one who could push him.
Yeah, so him and Button, even though they crashed and stuff, they never really... They were always on good terms.
Yeah, they crashed like... I think Canada was like when they... That was the bad one. Canada, but they didn't have like any big crashes like, say, Nico, Lewis, Spain, 2016.
Yeah, nothing that caused a fallout, really.
No. Like, they're very good, like, teammates, obviously, all of that. But they still managed, like, Button would push him for the wins, he would push Lewis. There was that challenge of, like, who's going to do better. But at the same time...
Yeah, because
their chemistry is good. So that's why I think he's the best. Valtteri obviously is the
best. I'd agree with that, yeah.
Valtteri, he says Valtteri is the best because he just hand him his wins.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah. Because Bottas wasn't fast enough.
Michael's going to say that my best teammate was Rubens, but like Rubens Barrichello was not like his best teammate. But
yeah, in terms of...
He just gave up the win for him, so like obviously he's going to call him his best teammate. So I don't see the argument to that.
Yeah, no, I don't agree with that. I say Bottas was his best teammate easily, to be honest, yeah. So to give context as to why Verstappen came third, I can't remember how good his lap time was. Actually, no, I think it was on for pole. Obviously, Red Bull started the media circus and were like, oh, he was like 4 tenths up after the first 2 corners and all of this. But what happened was Yuki gave Gasly a tow. Yuki was being given an engine penalty, so he had no business doing anything. But he decided to, he got into Q3, gave Gasly a tow to help him out. And then Perez helped Max with a tow. And then Yuki obviously... gets caught up, he's a bit slow, he gets out of the way, he's kicking up dust on the outside. I don't know why he was there, he should have just finished his lap. But then Perez gets distracted, moves out of the way, and then they're just going slow on the track. Max gets screwed
and
up.
And they absolutely, like, slay it. Like,
Red Bull, completely throw him under the bus. Like.
Yeah, but, like, what's his name? Franz Tost, I think his name is.
Yeah.
He came out and was like, it's not Yuki's fault. And I like that he defended him, because it's not Yuki's fault. Yuki did what his team wanted him to do, moved out of the way. It's not his fault that Perez had like a...
Completely, yeah. Like, I understand why Perez was a bit slow, but like, even then, it's definitely not Yuki's fault. You can't blame him for that. And the fact that the worst part is, it's one thing to throw a driver under the bus, but it's another one to throw Yuki. Like, everyone knows the relationship between AlphaTauri and Red Bull.
Exactly.
So you're not just throwing a driver under the bus, you're throwing a Red Bull, like, academy driver. Like, he's the reason... You're the reason he's in F1. He's still under your wing. And it's awful to you. It's just another embarrassing scene for Red Bull, to be honest. They're just... I don't know. It's just awful for them.
Perez gets a pole at home. Perez gets a podium at home, sorry.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there was... the scenes, his dad was so wholesome as well. That was great to watch. I don't know if you saw that, but his dad just shouting about... He's there. I think Perez's son was actually just at the bottom of the podium. There's a great picture of him looking at his dad on the podium in Mexico, which is... It's so sick to see. I love that podium. It's good stuff. And also, this was the first time we saw the flappy wing. This is the Red Bull wing. So Red Bull had an issue with their actuator when they opened the DRS. Rather than it just staying open, it started fluttering and it starts like waving about. And this was the first time this happened, which interestingly, you know, they're getting questions about this. Obviously, it's not completely illegal. It's not strictly illegal, and it definitely doesn't help them. But they didn't want to risk having the FIA look at that, because definitely it's a safety issue. If that thing falls off and flies off into someone, like, that's dangerous. So they had to figure out how to deal with that, because it was coming up with their... I think it was their medium. It was either... I think it was their low downforce wing, because there's a low downforce wing, a medium downforce, and a high downforce. And then a very low just for Monza. And it would come up in their low downforce, so they'd have to change their setup and use a different one, because it just kept happening. And this is something that kept happening until... I think we saw it in Saudi as well. Like, the wing was still flapping at that point. So this is when they started their investigation into Mercedes' rear wing. And they started talking about score marks and all of this. They were talking about something against the rules. And I don't know, what did you think of all of that? Just the...
war of words afterwards.
Useless.
It sums them up. They didn't actually end up like a
literally, fighting like, afterwards. There's nothing like you can do. I think what they did in like 2010, like with the new regulations, Red Bull at the time, they had like their their rear wing. So their rear wing under front wing. I think it's front wing. So under the forces applied by all the tests, it passed all the tests. But when you actually go on, like, because essentially carbon fiber can be directed, like you can have the fibers point in a certain direction. So it passed certain tests, but on the long runs, it would actually like lean down, so they can generate a bit more downforce and stuff. So that was really clever because it's within the rules. It passes all the tests and stuff. But this was just like, there was actually nothing there. Like the whole year was about like bendy wing, bendy rear wings. There was really nothing to it. It was just kind of like, you have to jump on something to distract from your car to their car.
Definitely, yeah. Because obviously there was the whole thing about, near the start of the year, the Red Bull wing, and they introduced new ways of measuring that and all of this. And honestly, it's just...
It wasn't just Red Bull. A few teams had like very bendy wings.
Oh yeah, they said, I think it was Alpine, someone said, had like a major one that might have been worse than Red Bull. They had to change that.
But everyone was so excited, obviously, on Red Bull because they were leading at the time.
Yeah, and that's why Red Bull wanted to change the focus onto Mercedes. They're like, oh, look at this. This wing is so bad and all of that stuff. We'll move on from wings and stuff to Brazil, actually. So this is the second race in the triple header. Max gets a $50,000 fine, or euro fine, sorry, for touching Lewis's rear wing.
I'd say this is the best weekend across the year.
Really?
So this, like, overall weekend, no worries.
Yeah, actually, to be fair, yeah, I'd say that.
Did he get pole?
So, Lewis gets pole for the sprint race. Then they say, oh, actually, hold on a minute, your rear wing's a little bit dodgy. So not to bring the rear wings back up again, but... Yeah.
He was thrown to the back of the grid because he had an issue with his rear wing.
He had an issue. It wasn't they were trying to finesse the rules. It was a genuine fault. There are three tests, one on the left, one on the middle, one on the right. They passed all of them but failed the one on the right by 0.2 millimeters or something. And they just disqualify him completely. Which is interesting because now...
No, but that's all right. If you're breaking the rules,
you're
getting
advantages. The FIA are following the letter of the law. They did this with Hungary. We spoke about Hungary with Vettel. It's fair enough. It's just so, I don't know, they're like strict in some places, they're lean with others, they're trying to implement stuff, it's fair enough. Lewis gets sent to the back. He then in the sprint race goes from, I'm pretty sure, so Bottas inherits the lead of the sprint.
Yeah, he takes pole position, or Lewis actually, because whoever, he wins, so Bottas goes on to win the sprint race.
Yes.
And he takes then pole position, or Lewis.
Yeah.
But Lewis comes back to P5, I think, and then
Lewis comes back to P5, then gets an engine penalty, which is pre-planned.
Pushes him down to P10, and then he has that crazy engine, and he just flies by everyone. And then we have that incident where Max pushes him out.
Yeah.
And I think if there was gravel there, Max is taking, like, no less than...
It's ridiculous. Literally everyone says that's a penalty, but for whatever reason, purely... Canada 2019. They don't want to. It's awful. It's
that philosophy of let them race.
Any penalty on him, and he would have finished third. Like, that's less points. Bottas would have inherited second, but
he should have gotten 5 seconds. 5 seconds.
He should have done, definitely. Yeah. He wasn't even told to give the place back or anything. Obviously, no. Lewis was ahead. He just outbroke himself to defend.
But that's what Max always does. He essentially can't defend, so he'll just brake so late, push someone out of the track, and then that's it. They're defend. This is what annoys me, is because what he's doing is, he's doing it based on their previous implementation of the rules. That's why I was surprised when they got like all upset about him doing that in Saudi, and then they're like, "Oh, you're getting a penalty." But he did exactly what he's been doing the whole year. Why you? He did it in Abu Dhabi, and then they're like. No, Lewis keeps the front position. He shouldn't get... No, was it he? He did it. Did he get ahead?
Yeah, he got ahead of Lewis. What, you mean lap one of Abu Dhabi?
Yeah.
Yeah, he got ahead. He was trying to overtake him. He got ahead, yeah.
And then did... No, Lewis cuts the corner.
Lewis cuts the corner.
And then he gets ahead. Okay.
But it was... Oh,
this is where the FIA really just... like, they embarrass themselves. From here on, they just embarrass themselves.
Completely. So, he's waving around in a...
He weaves a lot.
He's weaving as well, which is specifically... So, I looked up the rules between these two episodes to confirm. There's a lot of stuff about entry to the corner, a lot of stuff about defending on the straights. Once you get to the apex and beyond that, there's, like, nothing. So, you just have to go off what people have done in the past. Which is interesting because they just... Well, they're not consistent, so... You can't go off anything realistic.
It's because Michael Massey, has he been in driving before? This is the thing, like, Charlie, I think, was a team principal. So he understood, like, how you should drive and all of that.
He's been a race director for something else, but I don't think he's ever been an actual driver himself.
Yeah. So he was a team principal.
Yeah.
Charlie Whiting. So he knew what he was talking about, but like this guy, like Michael Massey, has no clue what he's talking about.
So I mentioned last time his Wikipedia page was just early life, one paragraph, and then the entire thing was just a mention of the controversy of Abu Dhabi. He's been Googled so many times now, they've decided to make his Wikipedia early life, career, notable controversies as race director. So before this was just Abu Dhabi, they've now added the Baku restart, the Belgium Grand Prix, which obviously didn't happen, the Saudi Arabian Grand Prix, which we'll talk about in a second, and then obviously the Abu Dhabi bit, which is still there. So, incredible stuff from Michael Massey. You do love to see it. That does move us on to Qatar, which the main conversation before the race was the drivers had a briefing about what's allowed and what's not allowed in racing. Leclerc obviously said that he would adjust his driving style to what was allowed and what wasn't. And they basically said different stewards would implement the rules in different ways.
Basically what Charles said is like, if that's allowed for Max, then I'm doing it.
Yeah. And then they said, oh yeah, but it'll be allowed sometimes, but it's sometimes not allowed. Lewis also said pretty much all the drivers were complaining. And obviously... Max didn't say anything because he knows what he has to do.
I think with Charlie Whiting, it was recorded, you'd see it, but there was transparency about what you're allowed to do and what you're not allowed to do. But this is just like, Michael Massey's just lost total control. Like, he actually has to be moved. And, like, you need someone who knows the rules well, who's, like, been, writing the rules, who's been a team principal or is, like, something like that, who knows how to deal with team principal. You need him... to come in and, or like her obviously,
Ross
to come
Braun,
in and like...
Please, like Ross Brawn, that would be so nice. Imagine, bro.
Anyway, so Max and Bottas, but mainly Max, get penalties for double wave yellows. This was because Gasly was on for a decent lap and then ended up... Actually, he kept his position by having his tyre blow up and his, what's it called, and his front wing... destroying itself. That brings out the yellow flags. That then means that he keeps his position of fourth at the time, but then he inherited P2 for the grid purely because of everyone else's penalties. This was also something that people complained about because, interestingly, they didn't know where people were starting. They didn't know, so does this guy's penalty get applied before this one and who gets how much of a penalty? So Sainz and Bottas, I believe, Sainz started 5th, Bottas 6th, but they didn't know which way round they were going to be until they actually got on the grid and it was the wrong way or something. Because normally they publish the starting grid like 3 hours before the race. So more stuff from the FIA, you love to see it. Incredible. In general, the race was pretty boring.
Lewis led from the start. It's kind of like a classic Mercedes win from 20 seconds ahead of everyone.
Yeah, Lewis just wins. Max makes back his 5 place grid penalty almost immediately and then comfortably finishes 2nd.
You have to say, like, Qatar was very easy to overtake. You're just overtaken to turn 1. That's it.
Yeah, this was exactly what people
did. It's done by,
want.
Like, turn 2, turn 3, it's over.
Yeah, it's just... I don't know, when people... DRS, when it was introduced, was so that people could regain the time they lost in the last corner and then make the move into turn 1. It wasn't so that they could just overtake in the straight.
Yeah,
The DRS was
OP.
DRS was powerful. The straight on the last corner, the move was done into turn 1 realistically. So, yeah, not great stuff. obviously more talk about the FIA in general, boring race. Yeah. Alonso does get his podium though.
That yeah, he did like a one stop. But obviously this is again like there were a few tire blowouts. Lando got another tire blowout.
Oh,
Lando yeah. was firmly inside the timing of the Pirelli. And then he had to stop. So this is what I was talking about in terms of Pirelli are very inconsistent with their tires. And they got like the they got like C5 compounds, so like they're very tough ones. And then like
it was the hard tire blowing up the hardest one of the lot, the C5, and even then it was blowing up.
Yeah, that's when you know like something's wrong with Pirelli.
It's a rough one. We'll see. They've actually said for next year that most of the races are gonna be a one stop or something, they're assuming.
Interesting.
So in theory that's all right if the cars are good enough, if the aero of the cars is good enough, then great because they're on track for longer. But if they're not, then two stops would be nice. Anyway, Saudi, I mean, we won't go into too much detail.
Yeah,
we've got an
entire race spoke about this way too much,
but there's like 80 incidents, 2 red flags early on. Interestingly, actually, I going back, Yuki and Leclerc, Yuki did this on I think it was Vettel and Leclerc did this on Sainz. They did the Verstappen, so they outbrake themselves and then defend the position and then come back across the curb. The fact Leclerc did this on Sainz, Sainz then said he needs to give the position back.
He gave the position.
I think he did, but it wasn't looked into at all, purely because they're teammates and no one really cares. And then I think Yuki just crashed afterwards or something. So,
yep.
Like, no one really needed to look into that, but you could see signs of them copying the Verstappen move, which will be interesting if all the drivers have fast enough cars for next time. Either way, Lewis wins, Verstappen gets penalties, blah, blah, blah. But his penalties are applied after the race and he keeps P2.
Yeah. I think the one thing you say, like, George complained about the track being dangerous. The track was only verified the day before...
Before practice, Thursday.
So I'd say the racetrack has a lot of potential. It's an incredible racetrack, like high speed, tight. It's the type of racetrack that you just love watching. The only issue is actually safety.
Yeah.
In terms of because the track wasn't actually verified like 2 or 3 months before, they couldn't fix the issues with the track. So it was kind of like, let's go out and see what the issues are.
Yeah.
And obviously with Michael Massey directing the race terribly, it just turned out like he kept them out for like 4 laps. Like this is the reason Lewis pitted, Valtteri pitted, because and then they came out and then he kept them for 4 laps. After 4 laps, you're like, okay, race is gonna keep going after this, and then he calls out. Why are you calling a red flag?
Yeah.
4 laps after a safety car, like a safety car has been out for 4 laps, then you call a red flag. That makes no sense.
This is
when you know like Michael Massey has no glories. He should have, the moment the incident happens in qualifying, the moment this incident happened or practice, Leclerc crashed, same corner, everything, red flag straight away. So why are you not red flagging the race? Red flag the race, because it's in such a crucial position, you need to move everything out of the way. It needs to be red flag. Why are you yellow flagging? You yellow flag it for 4 laps. If it's 4 laps in, then just wait 4 more laps.
Yeah, it's...
Why are you red flagging?
It's so weird, like...
Like, it just makes no sense. This is why people were very... This is why Lewis was actually very annoyed, because we've already done 4 laps. In the other one in Imola, they red flagged it straight away. So no one pitted and then came out, and then they were stuck at the back.
Yeah, this time they waited and then made the decision. And it's like, cool, yeah, wait and make the decision. But the fact this incident happened so many times throughout the weekend...
And even in Formula 2 as well. So they had reference of like how bad the crashes were.
Every time, but this was the only time someone crashed in that corner and it wasn't an instant red flag, so...
But I was right, I said that Lewis is going to win Saudi and they're going to go into the end. I called it, I was like, Lewis is going to win and they're going to go into Abu Dhabi, level on points, and that's what I wanted. And everyone else was like, no. And then after watching Abu Dhabi, they were like, you were right.
Yeah, they had Lewis to go in on titanium on front wing, sets fastest laps with half a front wing and all of this. Solid stuff, but yeah, it was mainly just, Saudi was just like drive to survive. It just was.
Yeah.
The whole thing was drama, nothing about on-track action. The on-track action was boring. Awful when it happened. Pretty boring and stuff.
Brake testing.
It was, it's just so much drama. All the stuff happened off track. And Verstappen himself, like, complains about this a lot. He's like, oh, we just talk too much about F1. We don't actually talk about the racing anymore, which is partly his fault, but mainly the FIA, to be fair.
I think if the FIA were a lot more strict, like, they're a lot stricter, it wouldn't be like this. But they're too busy trying to dramatize F1. That's the thing. Like, I told you, like, my friends who've never watched F1 came into F1, watched it. They found F1 to be way more exciting than football. And this, we're talking beginning of the season.
Yeah.
And you didn't need to do anything. You don't need to add anything to make the sport exciting. The sport is exciting.
Yeah.
What you're doing is you're actually getting people who love the sport, people who've been here for a long, even like when you get Harry Kane and Gary Lineker,
yeah,
commenting on like what just happened, you know that something's gone wrong, because people who literally have no clue about Formula One are like, what the hell just happened?
Yeah, it just needs to be made simpler. They need to listen to the fans. We had this chat like
it's
before.
Disgusting.
Like, we made a clip of it. Like, they need to listen to the fans, because the fans are watching for the racing and for the engineering.
Yeah, we're not watching for like you to like dramatize it and make it into something.
It doesn't need to be a film. Yeah, exactly. We don't need a love interest to come in out of nowhere and then have like, I don't know, the girlfriends come up. We don't need grid girls back. Like, that's not what we need. Like, it's just about the racing, realistically.
Yeah, I don't.
It's annoying.
Anyways, Abu Dhabi. Was controversial.
Well, it definitely was. So F1 get exactly what they want now. They're equal on points going into the last race. And then Abu Dhabi happens, obviously. Actually, there's an interesting clip that surfaced. It was, where is it? So people found this.
Screen's gone.
No. Oh, well.
We'll just finish it like this now.
We might as well. So, interestingly, So the amount of hype that this got, so the talking points were, is Max Verstappen going to crash into Lewis?
Yeah. I assumed he would, to be honest.
Like, I assumed given the opportunity.
They get Sergio Perez to do it.
Yeah.
Because then they can penalise the team, they can't penalise the driver. Because it's not Max's fault, it's the team's fault. You can clearly say it's not my fault.
I would have thought Max would have done exactly what he'd been doing all season, and then, you know, Lewis is completely, like, so cautious to try and make sure there isn't anything. But so they bring back a video. So there's videos on the F1 channel of the drivers reacting to certain incidents in history, and they bring up the Prost Senna crash, and he turns to Gasly, who was his teammate at the time, and they're like, okay, so what's wrong with this, or something like that, and he says, I don't see anything wrong with that. And this clip circulates on Twitter. Everyone's having a field day with this one. They're like, oh, you see that? Max said there's nothing wrong with this crash, so he would just wipe Lewis out into turn one. They get through turn one fine. Lewis overtakes him, and then
Max had a terrible start.
Yeah, awful start. He has like two pit stops. Perez holds up Lewis for him. All of this stuff happens, and then we all know what happens on the last lap. So that sums up the season, really. What did you think overall?
I think best season in a very long time. I think if I had to say, I'd say best improvement from last year, Lando.
Yeah.
Biggest surprise would be Carlos. Who else? I'd say also, like, if you're saying most improved as a team, I'd say Williams.
Yeah, definitely. They definitely
brought
strides forward.
Yeah. But I'd say overall, like, we saw a lot of fighting at the front. We saw a lot of fighting at the back. It wasn't like there was obviously a massive gap. I think everyone saw the quality difference between Lewis and Verstappen and everyone else.
Like, yeah.
Consistently, they were pulling ahead by like a massive gap. So I think now people have realized why Lewis and Max are as good as they are. But anyways, I think we can.
They have, yeah. They've realized that the two drivers, they're just in a league of their own at this point. So it'll be interesting to see who can actually keep up with them next year. I would say, yeah, like, performance of the season aside from the two at the front, you'd have to give it to
Lando,
Carlos, but, or Charles as well, he got kind of unlucky, but
I think
Lando
yeah,
gets it.
What
about worst? Other than Mazepin, you can't say Mazepin.
Probably Mick, maybe.
I don't think Mick could have done much more.
Gio Pratt, nah. I think that's the thing. I think Williams did incredibly well.
Yeah.
Maybe that's the thing. I don't think anyone did massively bad except Nikita and Mick Schumacher. I think they were the worst. Oh no, like worst.
I might give it to like Yuki or Kimi maybe.
No, Ricardo.
Oh yeah.
For the car he was in.
Right, he was lapped in Monaco.
If we're looking,
why Lando?
If we're looking at the car you're in, then I'd say the most disappointing, I wouldn't say he's the worst on track because he got a win and all of that stuff.
Yeah.
But I'd say the most disappointing for his car was definitely Daniel. Because you're in a McLaren that can go win and you consistently like P... You're not even making it into Q3, you're P16. Q2, sorry.
Yeah.
I just don't get that. I don't get that. I'd say he's the most disappointing because I think everyone expected him to just absolutely destroy Lando.
Yeah,
and just Lando just owned him the whole season. I think most disappointing, I'd say it's like Mick or Nikita Mazepin, I'd say. No one else kind of strikes me as done incredibly bad. But then you can't really blame them as much because the car was bad. So it's kind of like one of those things where you're...
Yeah, I mean, you can't blame Mick, but he did what he could. I'd say he performed as well as you'd expect him to, really, but... Mazepin isn't exactly much of a benchmark.
Yeah. I'd say like the surprising ones would be most improved as well. I'd say like most improved would be Lando, Carlos, but I'd say Nicky, like as in Latifi. His race pace has improved a lot this year.
Yeah.
If you watch him, like he's overall a much, much better. Like if you don't see him as a paid driver, you still get why he's in Formula One. His racecraft is getting much better. And I see why they kept him going into next season. He would be a very good... Like, he is getting... He's improving.
Yeah.
Not
yeah.
obviously, like... I think George as well, he saw a lot of improvement in his racecraft. He had that issue where he always drops at the beginning. But I think that's more along the lines of his car is just, like... He somehow...
The car and
yeah.
Quality, yeah.
And then when the race starts, it's just his car is terrible. Everyone thinks he's not doing well, but realistically, he's doing the best the car
can do.
It's
like Leclerc in Baku. When he got pole, he dropped behind Lewis and Max and the rest of them.
Yeah,
just because he outperformed the car.
Yeah, I don't think there's anything else to kind of ask from him. And I think Williams as a team, I think they did incredibly. I think we have to talk about like what happened to Latifi after the afterwards, like the amount of hate he got on social media and stuff. He apparently deleted the apps straight after, like all social media apps after the race. He was off social media for a few weeks. He got death threats. He obviously a lot of abuse and stuff, and I don't think that's fair because what do you expect from a Formula One driver? If you're racing for last place, you're still racing.
Yeah, the conversation that he shouldn't have been trying to overtake Mick and all of this because it was last, the stupid.
That makes no sense. You're racing. If I'm last, I'm still racing.
Yeah.
If last place don't race, what's the point of you just go retire your car?
Exactly. It's
because that's
it's
the thing.
Dumb.
If anything happens, you can jump from last place to points. If you're P15 instead of P16, you could be in the points if something happens. So I don't get the argument. It annoys me, and for him to get a lot of abuse like that, obviously you could see it coming.
Yeah, you could. Yeah, but abuse directed at Latifi at the end of the race is stupid.
Yeah.
Any,
I think
obviously hate directed at Verstappen and stuff and Red Bull. In terms of what happened at the end, unneeded.
Yeah.
Max just overtook and won.
Yeah.
The argument is with the FIA and Massey.
Yeah, I don't think him or the team are at fault. I think they did really well to respond to the situation and put on soft tires and to get after it. What the FIA did there, what Michael Massey did there, was just insane. You know, he might have as well just added, you know, like, wait, has Verstappen passed Lewis? No, plus two laps. Like, I wouldn't put
you
it
might,
past him
like,
to
like, here's the thing,
laps.
So people are actually saying, like, could it have been properly, like... Because the thing is, you've got to remember, like, this isn't them on equal tyres for end of the... This is Lewis on his one-stop old tyres from right at the beginning of the race to the end of Max on fresh ones. So he knows in his head...
Max is passing.
Yeah, like, you know...
And
like,
there's no DRS as well.
Like, there's no denying it. If you let them race for the last lap, if you're
Max
finessing the rules to let them race for the last lap... Then Max is winning, like. So you've chosen the champion. You've literally just chosen who you want to win.
Yeah, I think that was unfair for both of them because it's always going to be the case where Max's first championship is going to be like that, but then Lewis lost the championship because of that. So it's kind of unfair to both because it kind of stains his first championship, but he doesn't get his eighth, which he kind of deserved by the end. So it's, yeah, going into next season, I'm, I think, like, I'm hoping the cars are a lot closer. Obviously, with the way the wind tunnel testing time and the CFD time is arranged, one team is not going to be able to dominate, like, say, Brawn in 2009. So,
yeah, I mean, actually, I just want to get your opinion quickly before the end on the argument of, so what they say is, the idea is that you change the regulations, and that means that, you know, you bring down the fastest car, it's not as fast anymore, some other team finishes the regulations, and now we have different people at the front. But if you keep changing the regulations loads, and majorly, I know we've got a budget cap now, but that's the maximum you're spending, the bottom teams will still be like, a little bit under the cap.
No, but it was set for, like, the lowest team was spending 140 million, I think.
So, but the cap's like 165, isn't it?
Yeah, but that's almost the same.
Yeah, but, well, the thing is, if you keep changing it, more teams will be able to invest their bigger money and resources into next year, and then the next regulations and the next regulations.
But then,
surely if you just don't change the rules as much or as majorly and as often,
but
then the teams will end up catching up, right?
But then the problem is if one team has an advantage, that's what happened with Mercedes, is Mercedes is going to lead, and then it stops developing early and focuses on, like, the small regulations for next year and has already got a great car. And so that's the issue that comes up. Obviously, new regulations, the difference, you know, Mercedes' budget in the previous years used to be, you know how much it was?
No.
So,
is it?
The last team was 120 million. Mercedes used to spend 400 million.
Oh, that is the number I had in my head.
So you're comparing 400 million to a difference of 20 million. It's a difference of 20 million is nothing. That's That's literally the difference in that and that is literally like half of Lewis's salary. So it doesn't make a difference. It doesn't make a difference. But like when you look at it from the sense of Mercedes had like 300 million on their opposition. Obviously, they're going to be way better because they can spend way too much money on their car. That's not going to be the case from next year. And obviously, wind tunnel testing time and CFD testing time, we're going to explain this later on, but the way it's arranged is, even if you have an if you're first, so I'm going to just give a quick explanation now, but say you, Mercedes has like the least amount of time going into the season and so forth, so Haas has the most amount of time. It's set as a percentage. By mid-season, the summer break, everyone is given... So say if Haas is first then, Haas gets the least amount of time going into the rest of the season.
Yeah.
So there is a reset at the midway through the season for more wind tunnel testing time and more CFD time, and it goes to actual teams at the bottom who get a lot of time. Teams at the top don't get that much time. So what's going to happen is, you can go midway through the season, dominate the first half of the season, and then teams do research. They've seen what you've done. They add research on top of that, and they pass you.
It's a good way. No, in theory,
so
that's a good idea.
I think that's a much better way of doing it than, obviously, you're going to do that 5-6 years, then maybe change the rules a bit more. That's a way more interesting, and this is a better system, because now the what Mercedes used to do is by mid-season they're developing next year's car, they've already developed this year's car,
yeah.
So far they can't do that this year because by mid-year the other teams have like extra time on them to develop this year's car, so unless they're gonna give up this year's, there's no way to be able to dominate the second half. You're not guaranteed. They're gonna actually have to invest that time in this year.
It's a good dynamic. Yeah.
So essentially, you don't get teams going midway through a season developing next year's car. That's not going to happen. They're not going to be able to do that. Obviously, they're going to be developing it, but on a very small scale instead of turning like the whole factory towards next year's car with just small teams. That's what Mercedes would do. They turn the whole factory, develop next year's car, and just keep small teams on like reliability, essentially. That's not obviously fair to everyone else. But
yeah.
That's where we've been. We've gone off topic.
We have. And just one last thing, actually, I wanted to bring up. This brings us one step closer to having... No, it can't focus. I try focus it. This, if you have not seen this, is Tuned. I will link the episodes below. This is what McLaren said in 2012 would be the cars in 2020. It's a it's a floating bar of soap with a rear wing.
It looks like the Apple mouse.
Oh, it does. Yeah, it does. It does, actually. It does. This is so sick. But yeah, That is Lewis Hamilton and Jenson Button in what McLaren thought would be the 2020 car. Obviously, they've made more realistic concept cars. This is a joke car. But still, with the simplification of the aero rules, all I'm saying is the cars are one step closer to looking like this.
And that would look sick, you know, the cars would look
good. Bro, and they're floating and stuff. Mazepin 2032 world champion.
That's the future. It's going to be like a hover car instead of like tires.
Pirelli are gone from the sport.
yes. That's the way to get rid of Pirelli, is to make the car like a hover car instead of a car. That would be action. So you don't have any downforce and no turning speed anymore. So.
You see this? You see the amount of development that's going to go into this?
It's all in the engine, bro.
My degree would be put in the bin, you know?
It's all It's all in the engine now. You're saying that as if I'm studying a different degree. I'm in the same situation. Same boat as you.
What an episode, bro. I'll link Tuned below as well, actually. I've got a link Tuned. Tuned is great. But yeah, on that note, with this in the background as well, I've just got to say, Spotify have now, if you listen to this on Spotify and somehow made it to the end, released a reviewing system, if you listen. Give us 5 stars on that if you can, and on any other audio platform that you listen to. Like and sub to the YouTube, obviously. We haven't really said that before, but might as well. And yeah, we'll catch you lot next week for the, I think,
introductory series to Formula One.
I'm kind of a series explaining F1, and we'll go through the basics then.
Yeah, we're going to have one episode that's kind of very beginner friendly, so if you have no clue about F1, that's kind of directed at that. And then the week after, we'll kind of build on top of it and we'll discuss a bit more kind of complicated stuff. But yeah, we should have like 2 episodes across 2 weeks that kind of discuss everything you need to know to kind of sit and watch an F1 race and not be confused with anything.
Yeah.
Including like trim, so like what's an undercut, what's an overcut, oversteer, understeer, diff, deg, all that stuff.
Yeah, we'll go for everything. So there you go. Thanks for listening and we'll see you next week.